Good morning. And grace and peace, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and welcome you to our worship service this morning. Special welcome to any guests or visitors who might be with us today. We encourage you as well as everyone to sign in on the registration cards that can be found in the pews. We'd also like to welcome you to stay for a time of coffee and fellowship following the worship service today. Also want to welcome those listening in to our videotape ministry, those at Sibley Specialty Care, Kinderview Manor, Hartwood Heights, as well as our shut-ins and our homebound. For announcements today, I'm going to start with an announcement about our sticky faith, and I'm going to ask Maggie to come forward for that.
There you go. Good morning. Due to the snowstorms and stuff on Thursday, we canceled our Sticky Faith training and kind of our meeting. So we're going to have it today after church. All those who are juniors and seniors in high school and their parents, they can stay here. And then all those who are mentors, like face-to-face mentors, will stay. And also if you're a prayer mentor, you will stay because I have a list of all the people you'll pray for. And those who are writing letters, I will contact you later personally. But if you don't remember what you signed up for, just come anyway, and I'll direct you to the right spot. So that'll be after church to stay in the sanctuary and just move forward so we can talk within here instead of the whole sanctuary.
Good. Thank you, Maggie. Also want to remind that there will be two offerings today. The first offering will be for the Property Needs Fund. That Property Needs Fund takes care of any of those things outside our normal budget, emergency type needs. And the second offering will then be our mission fund offering. For Sunday Night Live, we have a special treat tonight. Bob Godfredson is gonna be giving his testimony. I say it's special because he's right in front of me. So if you'd like to come and hear that, please come at 5:30 tonight. Our notice also a change of date for a couple of meetings for Mission and Nurture and for the Worship and Evangelism because of the Ash Wednesday service. And that will be this Wednesday at 7 o'clock. I noticed that one of the adult Sunday school was reflecting on the fact that only 24% of people in the United States actually celebrate Lent, so this is a good way to kick off our Lenten season. Next Sunday, the ordination and installation service will take place on the first Sunday of Lent, as well as communion on that date. We are going to be doing a Lenten series called At the Crossroads, and there's some flyers in the back. Let's see if I can sneak mine out quick. That looks something like this, if you'd like to see what we're going to be doing. So those are in the back of the church. For sympathy and prayer concerns, we want to continue to pray for Dorothy Grote and her family at the death of her sister, Ruth Loritz, as well as for Gary and Jackie Leathers as they mourn the death of their mother and mother-in-law, Mary Leathers, who was passed away on the 16th. Her service was held this last week on Monday. For prayer chain concerns, just a few updates. Peter Wagner went to Avera McKinnon this week, but he did return home yesterday. So that was a good turnaround for him. And then Irma Tungett, who was 97, had hip surgery this week, if you can believe that. And she is going to hopefully return Monday, is what I heard. So that's pretty amazing at 97 to have hip surgery, and so that's a praise the Lord. Any other joys or concerns? If not, let us stand and greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ.
Thank you. join me in the call to worship. The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He is enthroned above the cherubim, let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion, and he is exalted above all the peoples.
Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he.
Exalt the Lord our God, and worship at his footstool. Holy is he.
He spoke to them in the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies in the statutes that they gave them.
Exalt the Lord our God, and worship at his holy hill, for holy is the Lord our God.
Let us pray. Holy God, you are God alone, creator of the universe and all that is in it. You have blessed us with everything we need. You have given us a gift of grace we don't deserve. Our hearts are filled with joy. We worship you and sing your praise, remembering you mighty, your mighty deed throughout history. All glory and honor are yours. Amen.
Let us continue to stand for our opening hymn, Sing Praise to God Who Reigns Above.
Prayer of confession. Merciful and forgiving Savior, every glimpse of Christ's glory
reminds us of the hope we have in Him, both now and for the future. It also reminds us of our own inadequacy and insufficiency. For like Elijah, a review of our lives reveals a mixed bag. At times we display courage, at other times fear. Faith is commingled with doubt. We are compassionate one minute and holding a grudge the next. Humility is not just
come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall become white as snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall become as wool. If you, O Lord, kept track of our sins, who among us could stand? Who could stand? But because you are a God of mercy, a God of grace, a God of love, we can stand before you in confidence, knowing that you will forgive us of our sins. Therefore, I declare to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we are truly forgiven. Amen.
While the men are coming up to sing, I thought I would tell the story behind the song that they're going to sing. I didn't plan to do this every time, but when I read this story, I thought, well, this is completely fitting for today. And the song that they're about to sing is Stand Up for Jesus. The year was 1858, shortly before the Civil War broke out, and Dudley Tyne served as his father's assistant at Philadelphia's Church of the Epiphany. And when his father retired, he was elected their pastor at age 29. At first, everything went fine. He was accepted, he was liked, but then he started to preach against slavery, and that didn't go over so well with some of the people who had more southern leanings. So he and his followers organized the Church of the Covenant in another place in Philadelphia, and his reputation grew. His sermons, his Bible studies, ministry reached far beyond the church walls. Dudley had a calling to lead husbands and fathers to Christ, and he helped organize a great rally to reach men. On Tuesday, March in 1858, 5,000 men gathered, and as Dudley looked over the sea of faces, he was overwhelmed. I would rather this right arm were amputated at the trunk than that I should come short of my duty to delivering God's message, he told the crowd. Over 1,000 men were converted to Christ that day. Now, as Paul Harvey would say, here's the rest of the story. As you can see from this picture, he went out to a farm one day. Go back one. He went out to a farm one day, and he was watching a corn thrasher in a barn, and his hand moved too close to it, and his sleeve was caught, and his arm was ripped from the socket, the main artery severed. When he appeared that he was dying, Dudley told his aged father, "Stand up for Jesus, Father, and tell my brethren of the ministry to stand up for Jesus, too." While hearing these words at Dudley's funeral, another minister, the Reverend George Duffield, told his congregation at Temple Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia. He wrote this poem from those words, stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross, lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. And it was soon put to the tune of another familiar hymn, and because it has become one of our favorite hymns in the Presbyterian Church and all churches today.
Soldiers of the cross, live While the men are exiting, we would invite Tracy Van Diepen's coming up for the children's message, and would invite any of the children to come forward at this time for the children's message.
All right, come on up. I have a few brave friends. What did you bring? Did you bring your pony? Awesome. Bring your pony up here. Hey, Weston, have a seat. All right, good morning, guys. How are you? Good, okay. Oh, there's a few more coming. Good morning. Thank you for joining us. All right, today what we're going to talk about is in a little bit, Pastor Terry is going to teach us about the transfiguration of Jesus. That is a huge word. Can you guys say transfiguration? That is a huge word. Now I'm going to try my best to tell you what it means. Okay, it means to change. Okay? And the story that Pastor Terry is going to share with us from the Bible, it's actually scripture, and it's a story about, and it's real, it's a true story, it's when Peter, James, and John climbed up a very big mountain with Jesus, and when they got to the top of the mountain, all of a sudden, and I have a flashlight in my pocket to help me, all of a sudden, Jesus' face turned like this. His face turned bright, and his clothes turned white. So Jesus' face turned bright, and his clothes turned white right in front of him. And then it goes on, and it tells us that there were four that went up, Peter, James, and John, and Jesus. But then when they looked around, there were two more men there. I call them Bible greats. It's Moses. Moses is the fellow that led the Israelites out of slavery from Egypt, and Elijah, and he was a prophet, a great messenger of God. And they were there just all of a sudden, and they had lived long, long ago. And then, if that wasn't wild enough, what happened next was a great big cloud came over all of those people, and from the cloud came a voice, and it was the voice of God. And it said, "This is my son who I love, who I am well pleased with. Listen to him." So all of this happened on the mountain. And those men, Peter, James, and John, were terrified. They were amazed. Did you really? Those guys thought it was so cool, and it was kind of scary. You know what? They fell flat down on the ground, and they were worshiping Jesus. And then Jesus did what he does a lot of times in the Bible. He came up to them, and he laid his hand on their shoulder, and he said, "Do not be afraid." And then when they looked at him, everything was back to normal. The cloud was gone. Jesus' face wasn't bright and glowing anymore, and he wasn't dressed in white, and Moses and Elijah were gone. What had happened was for just a few minutes, Peter, James, and John got to see Jesus as he really was in his glorified, the Bible calls it his glorified state, or how he really looks in heaven. Okay, now we know, where does Jesus live now? Does he live on earth? Can I see Jesus like face to face, like I can see Tanner? Can I see Jesus like that anymore? I cannot, because he lives in heaven, correct? Okay, but you know what? The Bible tells us that because Jesus lives in heaven now, it is our job to allow Jesus to shine through us. So by the things that we do, because we believe in Jesus and we love Jesus and we have Jesus' love in our hearts, people should be able to look at us and see Jesus. Does anybody have any idea what we could do, things we can do, or how we can act, or how we can treat others that would show people Jesus when they look at us? Anybody have any ideas? What if, Bailey, you're out on the playground and all of a sudden you see somebody fall down? Do you think if you walk over there and extend your hand and you help them up and you say, "Are you okay?" Is that showing Jesus? That is showing Jesus, right? If you walk by, that is not showing Jesus. And what if you see somebody that's lonely and needs somebody to play with, Weston, and you go over there and you say, "Hey, would you like to play with me?" Are you showing Jesus to them? You are, you're right. And so the more we can study the Bible and pray and come to church and learn about Jesus, the better equipped we are to show Jesus to other people. So, all right, will you guys have a prayer with me? Here we go. Dear God in heaven, thank you so much for all these friends that came forward today. And thank you for the wonderful scriptures that are in your book, the Bible, and all we can learn from them. Please help us to do our very best to follow your will and your way and your word so that others, when they look at us, they can see you. Okay, I have some bookmarks to share with you guys so you can take them home. And there's some scriptures on there that maybe one of your family members can read to you, or every time you get your favorite book out or your Bible out, and then you can think about Jesus. Here we go.
Thank you, Tracy. At this time, we'll have the deacons come forward for this morning's first offering, which is the offering for our property needs, and we'll be collecting out at this time.
But he was rebuked for his wrongdoing by a donkey, a beast without speech who spoke with a man's voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These men are springs without water and mists driven by a storm. Blackest darkness is reserved for them, for they mouth empty, boastful words, and by appealing to the lustful desires of sinful human nature. They entice people who are just escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom while they themselves are slaves of depravity. For a man is a slave to whatever has mattered him. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled in it and overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of their righteousness than to have known it and then to turn back on the sacred command that was passed on to them.
Our first gospel reading is from Matthew 16, 13 through 20, found in your NIV Bible, page 1524, NIV Children's Bible, page 1072. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and some others say Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Our hymn of preparation is "Teach Me Thy Way, O Lord."
Please remain standing for our gospel reading. We'll be picking up in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. Hear now the reading of the Lord's Word. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I'll put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." And while he was still speaking, a a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen, listen to him." And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground. They were terrified, but Jesus came and he touched them, saying, "Get up, don't be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, the actions of our lives be accepted, O Lord, as you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. If you notice, the story of Transfiguration happens just 6 days after Jesus is confessed to be the Lord. And a time when Jesus explains to the disciples that the Son of Man will appear. These stories set up the Transfiguration and the road ahead for Christ. Now, going back, the region of Caesarea Philippi is a Gentile region, and it's the location of the Cave of Pan. You see the ruins of it here, considered by many to be the gateway to Hades. It seems Jesus deliberately came to this location for an object lesson, so the disciples could see that Jesus' messianic mission was going to be confronting evil head on. And Jesus' ministry, if you remember, began with his temptation in the desert with the devil. And now his ministry will end defeating Satan on the cross and in his resurrection. And so Jesus questions the disciple in front of this. Who do the people say that I am? He invites them to consider just what kind of Messiah he is. And they respond with what many of the people are saying. Well, you are a great prophet. But that's not the answer Jesus was looking for. And Peter responds properly. He says, "You are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God." Now they are standing at the entrance of this legendary gate of hell, and Jesus tells Peter these words, "Not even the gates of hell, or Satan for that matter, is going to prevent my ministry from being completed." It's important for us to understand that the vision the disciples had and the rest of the world were hoping for, though, was not what Jesus was about to reveal to them. Jesus had a new vision and a new hope and a new future in mind for them. Remembering that the Jews' expectation of the Messiah was someone who was going to come and take care of whatever evil regime was overpowering them through some sort of violent resistance, they thought, and bring them to triumphant victory so they would be over all their enemies. This is not the vision Jesus was casting for his disciples. But even his disciples were having a trouble following this sort of thing. Because when Jesus told them earlier that he was going to Jerusalem to suffer and to die and rise on the third day, it was too much of a leap for them. And that's why Peter says, "Never, Lord, never. This cannot happen." And remember what Jesus' response was to Peter? "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You don't even have the mind. You have in mind the plans of God, but the plans of man." Jesus was not so much scolding Peter here as Satan. You see, the real battle that was ahead was with Satan and his influence over all of humankind. And with this backdrop in mind, Knowing all this just happened, Jesus is taking his three disciples, his inner circle of Peter, James, and John, up a mountain, a high mountain, we are told. What mountain that was, we don't know for sure. Mount Hermon is the highest mountain that is located nearby. In fact, it's the closest mountain to the Cave of Pan. They're only several miles from that mountain. Another possible place is Mount Tabor, and it's just on the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and it's only about a day's walk. But any attempt for us to have to know what exact mountain did Jesus go up is not what's important here. What's important is what happened on that mountain. For when Jesus and his disciples started up the mountain, they should have gotten some sort of indication that the three of them are going off with Jesus and they're going up a mountain. They should have already have had their radar on, thinking, okay, something's going to happen here. But none of them, I believe, expected what happened when Jesus was transfigured and his face shone like the sun. In Greek, transfigured means Jesus undergoes a metamorphosis, similar to what a butterfly goes through. It changes from one thing to the next. And Tracy actually described it quite well, in that the disciples were witnessing, knowing that they were with the incarnate Jesus, who was God in the flesh with them, change then into his true form as the Son of God. The disciples get to see a glimpse of the Son of God's glory, of what he will be. This is what Peter gives witness to in our epistle reading for this morning. Peter makes reference to something he was witness to give credibility to his testimony. And I apologize, the verse I had Justin read was actually the wrong one. It was supposed to be 2 Peter 1, so that probably is not going to match. But here's what Peter was doing. Peter was using this story of the Transfiguration, out of all the other events he could have picked from. He picks this event to show that what they are saying is true, because they saw Jesus in his full glory, and they were witness to his majesty. Now, biblically and theologically, metamorphosis has to do with God's transforming purposes, and not to be confused with any human longings we might have or any wishful thinking that we can somehow change ourselves, such as a popular thought today is to become a transgender. Depending on how I feel, I can change my sexual identity. What happens to Jesus is something only the sovereign God can do. And when it said Jesus' face shone like the sun, only a divine power could do that, because he was not reflecting the sun. His face was shining like the sun. Only God can do that. Further reinforcing the sacredness of the moment is that sudden appearance with Moses and Elijah. It's as if they are pointing Jesus as the climax to all the law and the prophets that has stood for from the unfolding of the history of Israel. It's going to partake in the coming of Christ, in Christ himself. Now, as you can imagine, Peter, James, and John are awestruck by this. In this picture, they're shielding themselves from what is happening. And if not, they should really be stunned into silence, but not Peter. Peter speaks his mind. He says, it's a rather inflated view, though, of what he speaks, if you really listen to his words. He says, it is good for us. It's good for us to be here, Lord. If you wish, I will make for us three shelters. I'm going to put up three shelters. What Peter's wanting to do is build a memorial to capture the moment. Now, if this would have happened, say, today, I think it would have been like this. It is good for us to be here, Lord. Let us all get together, Moses and Elijah, and let us take a selfie. I want to capture this moment. That's what Peter was wanting to do. He wanted to capture the moment. But God wouldn't have any of that. That's when the cloud came down over them. Now, back in Moses' day, they should have known that a cloud was very significant. A cloud was what guided those Israelites through the desert by day. And whenever God was present in the tabernacle, a cloud would settle over the tabernacle. And so the presence of a cloud should have gave them an indication that God was with them. But if they had any doubts, when they heard his voice, they knew for sure. They were terrified as the voice out of the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen. Listen to him." At the end of this unbelievable event, the three disciples go down off the mountain, knowing what we've just talked about. Jesus tells them, "Don't tell anyone." Can you imagine that? They've just had the most unbelievable experience of their lives, and Jesus says, "Don't tell anyone until I am raised from the dead." Even that thought had to scare them. It's a similar warning that was given to Peter when he declared that Jesus was the Christ. He said, "Don't tell anyone that I am the Messiah." The Transfiguration, what it does for them and what it does for us, it confirms Jesus' mission. And Moses and Elijah being there validated. Jesus' journey to Jerusalem and to the cross was going to be difficult. From this point on, Jesus would put his face to the cross. He was headed to Jerusalem. It was going to be difficult, if not in itself an extraordinary event. No one was going to understand what Jesus was about to do. No one. Considering what had happened in the last 7 days, Peter, James, and John, their minds had to have been swimming. First, their beloved master is talking about his death. And then Peter's rebuke shows that they don't really understand Jesus' mission of the cross at all. And then seeing Jesus transform into his divine nature confirmed that Jesus was truly the Son of God. Witnessing Jesus talk with Moses and Elijah should have been the ultimate photo op for them. And it almost should have felt like it was like dreamlike. I'm not really believing what I'm seeing. But the voice in the cloud should have reminded the disciples of Jesus' baptism. Remember the baptism? Jesus is baptized. He gets out of the water, and a voice, not from a cloud, but a voice, says much the same thing. "You are my son, with whom I am well pleased." For us to make that narrative connection is something we can do now. It's easy for us to do. And it serves as a crucial link in underscoring the unity of Jesus' mission from beginning to end. From being baptized to his public ministry, to the cross, to the resurrection. Something that probably did not become clear for the disciples until after Jesus died and after they received the Holy Spirit. And also, just as Jesus' baptism inaugurates his public ministry, the transformation marks the heightening of the stakes of his ministry of the cross and the tomb. It's no wonder that Transfiguration Sunday happens on this day, the Sunday before Ash Wednesday, and the coming events of the 40 days of Lent leading into Holy Week. Now, the instruction from the cloud to listen to Jesus isn't so much as a rebuke as an encouragement to recognize and to follow the one who best exemplifies what it means to be a beloved child of God. Yes, Peter wanted to build a monument. He wanted to capture the moment. He wanted to prolong it as long as he could. But what God wants for us is not to build memorials, not to build things. He wants us to be living memorials for him, who reflect Christ in how we conduct our lives, both now and in the future. Tracy touched on that with the kids. And what our world could use right now is really, as you think of what's all going on in the world, is for us to hear that booming voice again. This is my son, whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. Wouldn't we like to hear that now? And yet I agree with Peter Kreft's statement. It said, our culture has filled our heads but emptied our hearts, has stuffed our wallets but starved our wonder. It has fed our thirst for facts but not for meaning or mystery. It produces nice people, not heroes. Yes, God, come and fix this world we live in. We want to hear you, yet really when you think about it, God already did. He made it possible for the world to be fixed by coming to us and dying on the cross. Not only dying, he gave us the Holy Spirit so that we can be living memorials who reflect Christ in all that we say and do. And for us to be a living memorial, first we need to do some of what Jesus or what God told the disciples. We need to listen to the one whom God is well pleased. Christ is the only one who knows what we're up against. He was here. He's encountered everything we are encountering. And the thing is, we just don't sit still long enough, not only to listen, but to reflect on his glory. And such glory for us is not an entitlement or a privilege of being a follower of Christ. It's a source of a sacred empowerment from on high that's given to us, the Holy Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can energize and equip us to go forward, to be that living memorial for Christ. Oh, that we could have that transfiguration moment for God. But God isn't calling us to stay on that mountain. We are called into the daily ministries of walking with Christ in the world in which we live. Susanna Wesley had a prayer I think answers our prayer for us at this particular time that we should all live out. It goes like this. Help me, Lord, to remember that religion is not to be confined to a church or closet, nor exercised only in prayer and meditation, but that everywhere I am in thy presence, which basically means everywhere I am. God's glory, God's Spirit is not something we bask in, but it's something we share. It's something that others can see in us and see Christ in us as we reach out to the world around us. We need to be a living memorial. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our Father, as we come before you this morning, we offer our thanks that you are always present to us, even though there are times when we are not present with you. We thank you that you call each of us by name, even though there are times when, unfortunately, we take your name in vain. We are sorry for the times when we have been present. We should have been present with you. And for all the times when we've looked for you in all the wrong places. We ask, O Lord, that you instill in us a sensitivity to your presence, that we might find your glory in the majesty of a sunset, or the glory in a smile of an innocent child. We are thankful that when we find a human need and fill it, you are there. Awaken us to the opportunities for ministry that are all around us, that we might be a living memorial for you in everything that we say and do. Expand our horizons that we might know that wherever we are, you are there for us even before we speak. You have already found us. Help us to live out our lives that when we meet you face to face, we might hear your words. Listen to my son. Listen And on this day, Lord, we lift up those who have been on our prayer chain. We pray and give thanks that Peter Wagner is returning home after his stay in the hospital with problems with his kidneys, and that we pray that they will continue to function properly now. We also give thanks that Irma Tungid is going to come back to Sibley on Monday following a miraculous surgery on someone who's 97 years old, Lord. That is just amazing, the work that you do. We just pray for continued healing for her. We pray for those that have been on our prayer chain of concern for some time as we lift up Pam Woolmuth, and we pray for her as she continues to battle cancer. And for Eliza Jansma, as he also is battling cancer, we pray for him. And Lord, we also pray for those who have lost loved ones recently. We pray for Dorothy Grote and her family at the loss of her sister, Ruth Lawrence. For the family of Mary Leathers and her family, for Gary and Jackie as they mourn her death. And Lord, just comfort them as only you can. We also pray for the family of Tilly Wietzma, for Tom and Gina Wietzma, Kim and Tom Doden, and their families, and pray that you would comfort them as only you can do. Oh, Lord, there's much we have to be thankful for. Lord, help us not to forget to do that, that we don't lift up our thanks to you daily of all that you do in our lives. And Lord, we do pray for all those who serve in distant lands, who are serving in the guard, and putting their lives in harm's way. We assure, O Lord, that your loving presence might be with them. And we pray for all those who work for peace and to help those in need. We pray for our president and his cabinet and all of his officers. We pray that he might make decisions that, Lord, are listening to your guidance and your direction. And Lord, we pray for not only our nation, but our community as we go forth, and our church, that we might be living memorials for you. And Lord, we pray all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We will continue our worship with the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Our scripture verse is from Psalm 50, verse 14, from the New American Standard Bible. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and pay your vows to the Most High. Thank you. Let us pray. What a gift you have given us, Lord, in Jesus Christ. Rekindle now our faith. Renew our spirits. Help us to overcome our fears and grant us courage as we go forward, as Jesus has gone before. In the gratitude of all Christ has done for us, therefore we dedicate these gifts and our lives to you in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We will continue our worship with our final hymn. God be with you. To God be the glory. Just a reminder that all those involved with sticky faith to come up front in the sanctuary after church. And I have to say thank you to Ben and Cindy for playing today. It's always a joy to hear that music. Hear now the benediction of our Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all God's people said, amen.